Lisa with Scripts and Scribes. We're at the Writers Guild Foundation TV Writers Symposium, and I'm kind of in shock right now because we're actually talking with Stephen DeKnight, who is the showrunner of Daredevil, which, you know, small, giant phenomenon.
That's a little show we did.
Yeah, a little tiny thing. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us. Okay, so before we jump into Daredevil, which I know is probably what a lot of people are like, let's get there, but I'd like to know a little bit more about your journey as a writer and kind of coming from staff writer to showrunner. If I have it correctly, your break kind of came on MTV, is that correct?
Yes, yes. I grew up in New Jersey, and then I went to Santa Cruz back in the 80s to be an actor. I really wanted to act. I had to act. Acted all through high school, and at a certain point I realized I was no Dustin Hoffman, and you know, I wasn't a Chris Evans kind of guy, so I couldn't get the small quirky parts and I couldn't get the bigger leading man parts, but I had always been interested in writing, so I started writing plays. And so I kind of studied acting and playwriting in Santa Cruz. And then when I graduated, I went to UCLA for their playwriting program as a grad student. And then hung around an extra year because who wants to get out of college and start paying their student loans? And I went through the screenwriting program. And then when I got out, I thought, oh, you know, 6 months, I'll be making movies and everything will be great. During that time, my...
It's really easy like that.
Yeah, you know, that's what everybody assumes. 6 months, maybe a year. Turns out, you know, I landed this job as an English as a second language teacher at a small Japanese school in Sherman Oaks. And that was my day job. And it lasted 6.5 years before I got a break. It took just forever. I would get close and then nothing would happen and nothing would happen. And with the MTV thing, I had a friend from college from Santa Cruz that was doing production work on the pilot for MTV's Undressed, if anyone remembers that show, teen sex comedy. Just oddly produced by Roland Joffe, who did The Killing Fields. So it was a bit of an odd mishmash.
Really similar.
Yeah, and so my friend said, hey, if it gets picked up, I can get your stuff to Roland Joffe's people. The show got picked up, and he says, send me your TV script. And I was writing features. I had written one spec TV script as kind of just an exercise, but it was a Deep Space Nine. And so I gave him this Deep Space Nine script and for a teen sex comedy, and he goes, all right, I'll send it. And it just so happens the head of Roland Joffe's company was a huge Deep Space Nine fan. So that's how I got my foot in the door. And I ended up working on Deep Space, not Deep Space Nine, I wish I had worked on Deep Space Nine, on MTV's Undressed. And during that run of me being on there, I figured, okay, I've got a job. I'd like to try to get, you know, a better agent. I had a wonderful woman, but she was at the end of her career at a small actor's agency. So I thought, now's the time to write another spec TV script. And I loved NYPD Blue and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, were my two favorite TV series. So I had ideas for both of them, and really it was like, which one do I do? And so I decided on Buffy, and my career could have gone in a completely different direction if I'd done the NYPD Blue. But so I wrote this Buffy the Vampire Slayer spec, and it got to Joss's people through my agent. And they wanted to talk to me about doing the animated show, but said Joss needs to read your script. And so they sent it to Joss, and I wrung my hands and chewed my nails for a month, and then got the call that, you know, Joss Whedon wants to meet with you. And I was like, you know, I heard angels singing. And I went and met with Joss, and he was fantastic. We literally talked movies and comic books for a half hour. Not the show, not anything. Mm-hmm. And at the very end, in his Joss way, he says, so, you know, I liked your script. And I know you're talking about the animated show. Would you like to come do an episode of the live action show? And I said, hell yeah. So they hired me for a freelance on that. And they invited me to the production meeting right before it started shooting. And at the end, Marty Noxon said, hey, can you hang around for a few minutes? And I thought it was going to be, you know, we need a rewrite here, we need a rewrite there. So I'm sitting there in a big room by myself for like 15 minutes wondering what's going on. And then a PA pops up and says, Joss and Marty want to see you on the set. And I thought, uh-oh.
Yeah, what did I do wrong?
And I go down, and I always remember it was the set of The Magic Box. And I went down, and Joss, again, in his wonderful Joss way, with no fanfare, said, you know, we like you, we like your writing, do you want to join us full time? And I almost burst into tears. And it was really the start of my career. I mean, Joss just plucked me from obscurity and taught me so much, like he did all of us, me and Drew and Doug Petrie. And it was really like a master class in drama. And the great thing about Joss is that he didn't just have writers. He wanted to train you how to run your own show. So unlike other showrunners, you know, he would have you in editing and all the meetings, on set, casting, everything. He gave a bunch of us our first chance at directing. He gave me my first shot at directing on Angel. And just to be around someone that brilliant and that supportive was phenomenal, really, really the highlight of my career.
And I'm sure that plays into how you operate also as a showrunner. You know, you probably want to be that encourager as well.
Absolutely. I want my writers to be on set. I want them to be in editing. Those are the two best places a writer can be, is on set and in editing, because mm-hmm. that's where you really see how things are put together.